Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. At question number one, I call Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it plans to achieve its net zero and just transition goals.
Minister Alistair Allen.
The Scottish Government continues to develop Scotland's next climate change plan that will provide strong and credible policy action to deliver emissions reductions. These policies will be underpinned by our enduring commitment to a just transition to net zero and supported by the development of just transition plans for sites, sectors and regions to ensure a greener, fairer future for Scotland's people. Pending the passage of the bill by the Parliament and the setting of carbon budgets, we anticipate that the next climate change plan would be laid in draft in summer 2025.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? That is useful timetabling. But given this morning's announcement by Petronius that 400 workers will lose their jobs in Grangemouth when they shut their oil refinery, what support will those workers be given, given their skills, their knowledge, their experience, if we're actually to see a real just transition?
Minister.
Well, the member is right to point out the importance of Grangemouth and obviously the concern that is shared by the government about the announcement by Petronius about their plans to cease refining in Grangemouth and the impact that will have on many workers and their families. I have made clear to the business community in Scotland, including that particular sector, the importance of a just transition for Grangemouth. The workforce there is highly skilled and perfectly equipped to support the deployment of new technologies at Grangemouth in the coming years. Indeed, the first meeting that the First Minister had with the Prime Minister focused in part on the criticality of securing just such a just transition for Grangemouth.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Full delivery of our ambitious net zero agenda will require full funding, and yet the Scottish Government faces an almost 9% cut to its capital budget. So given there is a significant upfront cost to reaching net zero, can the Minister advise to what extent achieving our climate goals will be contingent on the UK Government reversing capital cuts?
Minister.
Well, the member is, of course, quite right, and needless to say, the real terms cut of 9% to Scotland's capital budget has had an incredibly damaging effect on Scotland's ability to provide essential funding to a number of important projects and programmes, including those in the net zero space. Scotland and, indeed, other devolved governments depend on the UK Government coming to appreciate that fact if we are to drive forward meaningful and impactful net zero policy.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. Of course, funding will be crucial to achieving our net zero targets, but part of that will come from the ScotWind leasing round resources, which, as the Finance Minister announced last week, are to be diverted away from that objective. The GMB Scotland Secretary, Louise Gilmore, has condemned this as squandering the money and that Scotland's future in renewables is being frittered away. Does the Minister agree?
Minister.
Well, the Government is giving careful consideration as to how remaining ScotWind funding can be deployed, and obviously we wish to minimise the use of ScotWind money and put monies back in as we intend to in the future as we did in 2023-24. There is a 10-year just transition plan, as I say, of £500 million for the North East, for instance, which indicates our commitment to the future. But we appreciate the position, and I hope the member appreciates the position that Scotland has been put in by the UK Government, and I know that he would not, and members would not, wish us to see more money come out of public services to try to cope with that eventuality. Scotland has no levers available mid-year to deal with the crisis or the difficulties imposed on us by the UK Government, other than through the reduction of spending on public services or through making sensible use of resources like the one the member mentions.
Question number two, Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the most recent recorded crime in Scotland statistics, which shows a 22% rise in crimes recorded under the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 in a single year.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Domestic abuse is abhorrent, and whilst any case is unacceptable, these figures do demonstrate that Police Scotland have been able to proactively utilise these new domestic abuse offence powers. I hope this will further increase public confidence in reporting incidents of domestic abuse, and I would encourage anyone, whether a victim or a witness, to contact the police. We are committed to working with a range of partners in the statutory and third sector to tackle domestic abuse, to bring the perpetrators to justice, and to ensure victims receive the support that they need. Our Equally Safe strategy, which is backed by £19 million of annual funding, is aimed at preventing and eradicating violence against women and girls, and is focused on early intervention, prevention and support.
Pam Gossall.
I thank the Minister for that response. Domestic abuse is an appalling crime that is ruining so many lives in Scots. The figures are shocking, and 95% of these crimes involve a female victim. Current SNP government policies are not protecting women enough. I recently put forward a proposal for a new violence against women unit within Police Scotland. Will the government consider that proposal?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased. I think Ms Gossall is meeting with the Cabinet Secretary next week, and I'm sure she would be very happy to consider all proposals to make victims of domestic abuse lives easier.
Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's important to highlight the woman whose courage has brought into the open the misogyny and sexism that underpins domestic violence against women and girls that still exists in society today. With this in mind, what can government and this Parliament do to change those societal attitudes?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I think the member raises a really valid point. Those that perpetrate violence and abuse, the majority who are men, must change their actions and behaviour. It's only through fundamental societal change that women can be protected. We must root out the tackle toxic masculinity and gender inequality that leads to violence, harassment, misogyny and abuse against women, and we should stand against it and call it out whenever we see it. As announced in the programme for government, we will introduce a misogyny bill that will create a new offence related to misogynistic conduct, informed by the working group's report and subsequent consultation on draft legislative provisions to implement the report's recommendations.
Question number three, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting the renewables economy in the north-east of Scotland, including through the retraining of energy workers and enhancing supply chain development.
Minister Alistair Allen.
As our programme for government sets out, the Scottish Government continues to take significant action to grow our renewable sector and to ensure a just transition. Through our Just Transition Fund, we have already allocated £75 million to projects in the North East and Moray, including £11 million for skills and retraining initiatives. We are investing up to £500 million over 5 years to anchor our offshore wind supply chain in Scotland. We are kick-starting this commitment with investment of £67 million in the sector this financial year. These investments form just part of the approach that we are setting out through our new Green Industrial Strategy, published yesterday, and the Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan, which we are publishing shortly.
Michael Mara.
Of course, instead of investing £460 million of ScotWind money in supply chain development and training in the North East, an investment for the next 30 years, the SNP have squandered it on getting through the next 3 months. He says that the position has been put in by the UK Government, but he chooses to ignore the Scottish Fiscal Commission, the Fraser Islander Institute, Audit Scotland, who say this is down to SNP incompetence. But surely the Minister can't ignore the views of the Deputy First Minister, who in this chamber on 27th of March said to the Finance Secretary that he wanted to ensure that we will not lament money raised through ScotWind being poured into the SNP's black hole. So does he agree with the Deputy First Minister that this situation is indeed of the SNP's making?
Minister.
Well, needless to say, all of that was nonsense. And
Let's hear one another.
The reason I say that is because the UK government themselves have pointed to a black hole in their own finances. The UK government themselves have indicated that they intend to see things getting worse. Yeah. As I have indicated, there is a massive
Let's
cut.
Let's hear one another.
As I have indicated, there is a very significant cut to our capital budgets in the coming years. And if the member has any influence with the UK government, he will perhaps indicate these facts to the UK government and perhaps indicate that it might be better if things got a little better in the future rather than worse, particularly when Scotland is in a position of seeking to meet public sector pay deals and seeking to provide public services in Scotland in the teeth of austerity from a UK government.
Brief supplementary, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you. Presiding officer, both the SNP and Labour governments are failing to support the oil and gas sector in the North East. The SNP have a presumption against new oil and gas, while the Labour's disastrous windfall tax will risk 35,000 jobs and wipe £13 billion of economic value off the sector. Neither have a plan for a just transition. So will the Minister end the SNP's attack on the oil and gas sector, stand up for the North East and support the Scottish Conservatives' plans to create a national centre for green jobs in Aberdeen, deliver a jobs-first transition and give everyone the right to retrain?
Sir.
Well, the Scottish Government is committed to giving people the right to retrain. And, for instance, as I've indicated, some of the areas in which the Scottish Government is active on that, not least in £500 million being allocated for offshore wind, not least
Minister, I'd be grateful if members could, just don't interrupt when people are speaking. That way we can all hear. Minister.
And also, presumably the member doesn't want to hear about this either, the Just Transition Fund of £500 million as well. The Scottish Government appreciates the stresses which the North East economy has experienced because of the changing situation in the North Sea Basin and because of the changes that our economy will face. And we are committed to reskilling and providing opportunities to people to make that transition, a just transition into the future.
Question number four, Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the latest achievement rates for modern apprenticeships across all frameworks.
Mr Graham Day.
Presiding officer, modern apprenticeship official stats covering quarter one were published by SDS on the 6th of August, and it's encouraging to see that the ME achievement rate is now 83.2%, an increase of 5.7% percentage points compared to the same point last year. So far this year, just over 5,000 individuals have achieved their ME, allowing them to continue progressing in high-quality employment opportunities within their chosen career path.
Neil Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Housing is critical infrastructure. It's critical for achieving net zero, critical for economic growth, and critical if we're going to tackle the housing emergency. And while he quotes the figures overall, those are not the figures for the construction industry. The latest figures show that only 62% of those leaving the building modern apprenticeships did so having completed their apprenticeship. That's down from 71% 7 years ago. So what plans does the government have and targets do they have to correct this? Because ultimately, don't we need to improve those achievement rates if we're going to take growth and transition and indeed tackling the housing emergency seriously?
Minister.
I absolutely agree with Daniel and Johnson on that point. We do need to improve those numbers for that particular sector. We're working very closely with CIDB, amongst others, to address some of the issues there. He will be aware that there was an apprenticeship backlog emanating from the COVID pandemic. There have been issues about how we've addressed that. There's considerable work ongoing to do that, and I'm optimistic that will be addressed, but I absolutely agree with him on the point he makes.
Question number five, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it is taking to protect the provision of instrumental music tuition in schools.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
This Government has transformed instrumental music tuition in Scotland schools by supporting our councils to eradicate unfair charges. This financial year, we are providing £12 million of funding to local authorities to support the continued delivery of free instrumental music tuition as part of record funding of over £14 billion provided to local authorities in the budget. Local authorities are ultimately responsible for ensuring access to music tuition for pupils in schools across Scotland, and the most recent instrumental music survey published in December of 2023 showed that the number of pupils participating in instrumental music tuition is at a record high since the survey began.
Whittle.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? But in my area, in East Ayrshire, the plan is to move music tuition from local authority control to a trust. Concerns have been raised by constituents that the definition of free tuition pertains only to those who are in S3 to S6 and doing SQA exams and therefore will remain within council control as statutory school education. Music tuition out of this cohort will not be deemed statutory education and after being transferred to the Trust will be out with the council's control and therefore under threat. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that music tuition is a statutory service and should remain within council control and delivered by local authorities? And does she further agree with me that offering music education is crucial to a well-rounded education experience?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member raises a really important point, and of course I'm aware of the issue in East Ayrshire. There's another local authority, I think Highland Council, who deliver music tuition in a similar way, and ultimately it is a matter for East Ayrshire Council, who set their budget and are ultimately responsible for ensuring access to free instrumental music tuition. However, I accept the principle of the member's question. I've asked my officials to engage directly with this East Ayrshire Council on their proposals. I think it's really important we see no dilution in terms of young people's access to free instrumental music tuition as a result of these changes. So I'm happy to keep the member updated on that engagement, and I will speak to my officials again directly in relation to these proposals.
Question number six, Sandesh Gulhani.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recent Centre for Social Justice report, Where Have All the Children Gone?, which found that there has been a 72% increase in severe school absence rates in the last 5 years.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
School attendance plays an essential role in supporting our children and young people to reach their full learning potential, and our own data on persistent absence, published in March, paints a concerning picture, and I have been clear that there must be a renewed drive across government and our education agencies to help address and improve the situation. I have tasked Education Scotland to work directly with directors of education to improve attendance as a matter of priority. Education Scotland launched an online package of support for schools only last month, including guidance, professional learning and exemplification. And the interim chief inspector is also ensuring that persistent absence is addressed in every school inspection and identifying successful approaches which can be shared more widely.
Sandesh Gulhani.
Severely absent means children missing 50% or more of classes. 20,000 children in Scotland have avoided school for two or more days. 3,000 primary school children missed 50% or more in a school year. One in three children are persistently absent from school. A truly shocking picture. Worse than these dire stats is that the Scottish Government haven't bothered to monitor severe absence, meaning this Scottish Government have no idea of the true extent of the problem. These so-called ghost children are out of sight, out of mind and abandoned by this SNP government. Yeah. Is it any wonder that Scottish education is crumbling under this inept SNP government? So will the Scottish government finally begin to collect information about children who are severely absent from school?
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question, and of course he will recall that the children to whom he refers are those who lived through a global pandemic and lost out on 2 years. Well, I hear heckling from the Conservatives, but I don't think... I'm also mindful there's a school class right behind the Conservative benches today, and those young people...
Yeah. It's here, the Cabinet Secretary.
And those young people, of course, had their education disrupted for a period of 2 years. And, of course, we have seen an increase in relation to anxiety and a number of other reasons why young people might not be able to engage in their school education. Actually, I think it is worthwhile pointing out to a number of actions that have been taken, but I have been engaging with the member's colleague, Liam Kerr, on this matter in relation to those children that are persistently absent from school. The challenge needs sustained effort, not just from government, but from local authorities who in Scotland have the statutory responsibility for ensuring that our young people do attend school. But it is why, back last year, I commissioned Education Scotland's report published in November, which is focused on improving attendance as part of our response to that. I've also tasked, as I intimated in my initial response, the interim chief inspector to work directly with directors of education. That includes ensuring persistent absence is addressed in every school inspection. We have
briefly
asked for additional
Secretary.
Data. Now, the member speaks to missing children. That's not how it's characterised in Scotland. Our measures are quite different, but we've added in a new data measurement that looks specifically at persistent absence.
And of course, Cabinet Secretary, I must ask you to conclude at that point. And Question number 7, I call Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to strengthen its Fair Work First guidance to support and promote the good practice example referenced in the guidance of providing a private, healthy and safe environment for breastfeeding mothers to express and store milk.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Our Fair Work First guidance currently provides good practice examples for supporting women at work, including providing safe spaces for breastfeeding mothers. Parent Club, our national online parenting platform, provides practical advice and information on rights for breastfeeding mothers on returning to work. I am happy to consider how best to provide advice to employers on supporting breastfeeding mothers in the workplace and strengthen action required to address labour market inequalities faced by women and other groups in our society.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I want to share the experience briefly of one of my constituents who recently returned to work. She said that she was disappointed to find that the lactation room was being shared with blood donation and first aid. She added that there were overfilled yellow hazard bins, blood splatters on the pillows and the fridge, which she was supposed to store her breast milk in, was being used for a surface as blood collection. She felt that this was unhygienic and a possible health and safety issue. When she raised it with her employer, she was told that this was the room or nothing. Thankfully, she's been reallocated an office space. But does the Minister accept that whilst there is existing guidance, some women are still not provided with a private, healthy and safe environment to express milk at work? Would he be prepared to meet with me to discuss how the 2005 Act could be strengthened?
Minister.
I recognise the concerning set of circumstances that the member has narrated to Parliament. Of course, we are in the period right now of refreshing our Fair Work guidance. I'm happy to take on board the issues that the member raises, and of course, I am more than happy to meet with the member to discuss the matters in more detail.